Before we begin our program, I would like to take a moment on behalf of DWN to express my gratitude to all of you for joining us today. We are truly honored to have attendees from around DePaul, including those in administration, who recognize the importance of this organization and want to share their support for our mission. We gather as a campus community today to celebrate the modern day Louises in our midst. We have done so year after year since DWN was first founded in 2003, and it has become one of our signature events. To us, a modern day Louise is a woman who exemplifies St. Louise de Marillac's qualities of spirit and service, compassionate personalism, and strong work ethic. As one nominator wrote in an award submission, St. Louise de Marillac was a woman who cared about others and got things done, and so does my colleague. I have a feeling that sentiment will apply to every woman we'll see highlighted today. This year, our event is part of the University Diversity Series, which shows how much DePaul values the type of programming DWN puts on and the ways we are able to bring different people together. I especially enjoy this event because of how it encourages women and men from across the university, staff, faculty, and students alike, to recognize DePaul women who make a difference in their lives every day. Before we head into our program, I want to take a moment to recognize all of the women who are currently members of DePaul Women's Network. DWN is an extraordinary group of staff and faculty who work to enliven and enrich the experiences across our campus community and create opportunities for personal and professional development through diverse and engaging programming and events. If you're a member of DWN, please raise your hand. There are many ways to participate with the network, from joining a team to becoming a member at large. This year, we now have an open enrolling process for becoming a member at large. So if you're inspired by what you see and hear today, I encourage you to visit our website and learn how to sign up. At this time, I'd also like to thank DWN's service and outreach team, which worked hard for months planning this wonderful event. Let's give them a round of applause. Center us and thinking about spirit and action this morning, please join me in welcoming Joyana Dvorak to the stage to lead our invocation. Joyana serves in the Office of Mission and Values and coordinates the Meet Me at the Mission Vincentian Heritage Initiative. She has been a part of the DePaul community for more than 7 years and continues to be passionate about bringing life to the legacy of St. Vincent and St. Louise.
Good morning. We begin this morning with a pause to reconnect ourselves in the tradition of contemplation, reflection, and prayer that ignited the fire within St. Vincent and St. Louise. It's important to get out of our ordinary routine to take stock of the goodness surrounding us. It is good that we are gathered today to celebrate women of spirit and action, women who mirror St. Louise de Marillac herself. Louise was a daughter of charity, a nurturer, a caregiver, a leader, a servant of the poor, a mother, a positively contributing community member, a faith-filled person, an educator, the foundress of social work, a worrier, a doer, a wife, a skilled laborer. She was a woman, and legend says that she loves the Cubs. She lived life intensely and enthusiastically and was a woman whose quest in life was to do the will of God with a deep faith in divine providence. She knew suffering and she knew love. Through this suffering and love, she became a woman of spirit and action. She welcomes the grace of God, which transformed her fretful heart into a courageous, generous, and compassionate heart that loved intensely, that welcomes the poor and abandoned of her time. Rooting herself in a deep faith, she lived joyfully. As people of action and spirit, I invite you to enter this sacred space this morning to join in a simple breathing meditation so that we might be more present in this moment of celebration. Take this moment to settle your mind, your heart, your spirit. If it helps you to close your eyes, close your eyes. Feel your feet firmly rooted and grounded in this community of support. And begin just to notice your breathing. Try to set aside any extra tiredness you might be bringing this morning. Set aside those lists of things to do so you may be fully present with all of us here. As you breathe in spirit. Breathe out love. Breathe in gratitude. Breathe out joy. Breathe in spirit. Breathe out love. Breathe in gratitude. Breathe out joy. I invite you to call to your heart, to your mind, all of the courageous, inspiring women who have shaped and formed you to be good, strong, beautiful, and holy people. Bring them into this space, knowing that we are honoring and celebrating them today too. Pause to recall what you've learned, to remember the wisdom that you carry with you. Savor a moment of solitude now, breathing deeply and holding these women with gratitude, returning them to your hearts. Spirit of life and love, weaver of the web of relationships, we give thanks for this community of women of spirit and action. We give thanks for the abundance of gifts they contribute to our world. We give thanks for those who came before us, paving the way with their courageous lives. We call upon St. Louise de Marillac to continue to lead and guide our hearts and actions. Louise, woman of spirit and gentle power, be with us as we juggle the invitations life offers and deepen our roots of trust in ourselves, each other, and the world. Bless us as we learn how to balance our days with deep care and grace. Louise, contemplative in action, remind us to create spaces to pause, to care for ourselves and our spirits, that we might care for others. Louise, innovator and risk taker, spark in us the desire to move beyond the limits imposed on us. Challenge us to find new ways to respond to the world around us with courage and grace. Open our minds and hearts to listen deeply to the needs of our community and respond with creativity. Louise, woman of collaboration, be with us as we continue to build this Incension community together, as we continue to dream of another world that we know is possible. May we celebrate with joy this community of love surrounding us today. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Joanna. Hey, good morning. Go Cubs. My voice might not be quite awake yet, hopefully you'll understand. So good morning and welcome, and thank you for being here, especially so bright and early after a long extended game 7. I feel very honored to be standing in front of you. I'm Kate Lohr, by the way. I'm the director of a service and outreach team and part of DWN. And I have the great honor of introducing our keynote speaker this morning. And I feel very honored not only to have that honor and opportunity to introduce you to an amazing person, but also to be standing in the presence of so many great women of spirit and action. And there's many familiar faces in here, which is a very amazing thing for me to see as well. So thank you again for being here. Francine Soliunas is our keynote speaker this morning, who embodies a modern day Louise and a woman of spirit and action in so many ways. A few months ago, I trekked down to the Loop to meet with Francine in anticipation of planning this event. I had met her in passing, I had seen her at DWN events, but I had never gotten the opportunity to really sit and have a conversation and hear her wisdom before. And that day, I remember it being a busy fall day, beginning of fall quarter, perhaps you can relate. It was the beginning of fall, students kind of new and returning, buzzing around campus, starting to settle into the routine with a renewed sense of urgency, buzzing between Lincoln Park and the Loop. I may have been buzzing with some of the same urgent, frenetic energy the day I walked into Francine's office. And while I walked into her office feeling kind of electric and spastic from all the to-dos and all the tasks and all the focuses on various things, when I left, I felt lighter and more hopeful. Had a renewed sense of connection, not only to myself, but also to DePaul. I remember leaving and saying, I think I just met my new best friend. I'm not sure she knew that, but that was true for me. Francine is a blue demon through and through. She's received both her undergraduate and her law degrees here at DePaul, and she's been an active member since. She's continued to serve our community in various roles, currently working in the Office of Advancement. Nominated as a Woman of Spirit and Action by Father Bill Herrick, he says Francine is deeply spiritual and radiates inner joy and happiness with everyone she meets. I certainly feel lucky to have received that joy and happiness just in the brief time I've been able to spend with her. He also says that she exhibits every day St. Vincent's motto, say little, do much. And yet, she has so much to say. So with that, I'm very happy to introduce you to your new best friend, Francine Soliunas.
I've been with DePaul now as an employee for almost 5 years. And I went from a college of law about almost a year and a half ago to the Office of Advancement. And one of the things, I knew absolutely nothing about advancement in terms of what I was supposed to do and how I was supposed to do it. So I saw that there was a conference for newbies that they could go to and learn a little about what they were supposed to do. Excuse me, and I asked Erin May, who she says she's not my boss, but she is, if I could attend. And so I asked someone, what does CASE, C-A-S-E, stand for? And they said, copy and steal everything. So that's my introduction, because I'm going to be copying and stealing a lot today. Not because I'm stealing them from others, but because there are things that I've shared in the past. And I said, I'm sure someone in this room undoubtedly has heard it, some portion of what I'm going to share. Therefore, I apologize in advance for making you sit through it again. But if you're hearing it again, it's probably because the message didn't sink in the first time. And the good Lord commanded that I once again try to enlighten. And so let me begin by telling you how unbelievably humbled and honored I was to be asked to deliver this keynote address today. I believe I've attended every one of the events for the Women's Spirit Award in the 5 years that I've been here, and I love watching the screen and seeing all the nice things that people have to say about the nominees. This year especially, because I'm one of the ones. And I will admit that I have gone through a tremendous amount of angst these last 2 months about what I would say today. So when I spoke with Kate Lohr about what DWN might want me to say, she sent me an email which said that in their reflections about the event, they thought about how our mission here at DePaul can ground us and unite us as a community during such a culturally tense time, and that they were hoping to find a way to honor, celebrate, illuminate positive voices around us, while also cultivating inspiration to rise up to the continuous challenge of nurturing a community dedicated to the dignity of each and every person, and to have some time for reflection and peace, while also honoring how that chaos might impact us individually and collectively as a community. And so I thought, yeah, right. Okay. So I thought about it for the last 2 months, and I really have angst over it, and concluded that I do what I always do, and particularly when given the honor to speak to a crowd of predominantly women, and talk about what I call the precious moments in my life that highlight my journey to becoming a woman, the woman of spirit. And I lay claim to this honor, not as a braggadocious way of defining myself, but as a way of paying tribute to all the hands and hearts and minds and souls and spirits that have contributed to my foundation, my preparation, my formation, and my transformation, all leading towards my ultimate attainment of personal pacification, I like to say, a sense of inner peace, a sense of centering with myself, my brothers and sisters on this earth, and most importantly, with my God in heaven. So when I talk about precious moments in my life, I'm speaking about what for me not only defined that particular period in my life, but the lessons that I learned that would eventually lead to me becoming the round, brown, close to the ground, with a little bit of gray atop the mound, piece of deliciousness that I am. That's the way I always describe myself. It fits, doesn't it? So when I thought about my foundation, I naturally thought about my family, the values that I not only gained from them, but inherited from a long line of ancestors. My poor parents were both born and raised in Louisiana. They both came from large families, and neither one of them had much formal education beyond a few years of high school. They both worked at least 2 jobs when we were younger, and me and my 5 siblings were well raised by them, along with a village of aunts, uncles, elders in the neighborhood, and all the deacons, saints, and missionaries from our church. And while we all knew early on that we were special, I in particular knew from the age of 5 that I had a one-way ticket to the kingdom. So I was given to reflect on this first precious moment because of something I was asked to do by my church just before I started my employment here. I'm a member of St. Clement Church, and I've been for almost 50 years. And we've gone through a period of trying to get our parish members more engaged. And one of the things that we've done is we've celebrated 5 anchors, praise, serve, give, learn, and belong. And each week, we've asked one of the parishioners to tell the story of stewardship. I think the pastor probably chooses, along with the pastoral council, who's going to give the talk that week. So about 5 years ago, I was asked to do the stewardship piece for the bulletin. our church bulletin. And this is what I wrote, and I think it sums up a lot, pretty much about my childhood. Hush up, God is talking. This was an admonition I heard practically every Sunday in church, and more often than not, it was directed at an adult. For as a child, I had no doubts about the behavior expected of me as a church member. I knew that when I turned 5, I would begin my preparation to be saved. So to be a saint of the church, I knew I had to testify each Sunday about how God had helped me through the previous week, and I was expected to recite and discuss the scriptures for the coming Sunday morning. I knew to raise my finger, bow my head, and walk on my tiptoes in order to beg God's pardon when leaving the sanctuary during service. I knew that tithing was God's way of feeding his family, and that if God's family didn't eat, we didn't eat. And I knew that singing in church allowed me personal quality time with him, because that was when I could show that I was angel material. And if I did all that was commanded of me, when I reached the age of 7, I would be saved, sanctified, and filled with the precious Holy Ghost through baptism. I would be young Sister Stewart and one of the saints of Whole Truth Pentecostal Church of God in Christ, and forever be rocked in the bosom of Abraham. It was the happiest time of my young life. So as I reflect on my more than 40 years here at St. Clement, I know now that my story is not about what brought me here, but what has kept and sustained me here. In short, I've been able to reestablish and nurture the grounding given to me as a child, the knowledge of what is expected of me as a church member, the ability to understand, share, and grow in my faith, the feeling that my worship space is sacred, the belief that my stewardship, in whatever form it takes, helps God to abundantly nourish all who hunger, and the unbridled joy experienced in knowing that God listens and smiles when we sing together. It is now the happiest time of my life, because no matter what ails me from being about here, I can hush up knowing God has spoken. So that was my childhood, and that pretty much establishes for me what it was to grow up, particularly in Chicago on the west side. So, and also for me, my status as a saint, and thus a budding woman spirit, was sealed growing up. And to add to that, I was born on St. Valentine's Day. So I was almost 10 years old before I realized the world was not celebrating my beatification. Needless to say, while I did discover that I was not a real saint, and that Hallmark did not create a special card just to celebrate my birthday, I knew and understood that family and faith would be the bedrocks of my life. I knew that no matter what perils I faced in life, I would never be without them. That I could draw strength from both during those times when I had nowhere else to turn. But I also learned that both necessitated an unwavering commitment to love and patience. Easy to do with faith, not so easy to do sometimes with family. But I was an obedient child to my parents, and I had to be, because my mama did not believe in timeouts. We had punished the old-fashioned way with straps and switches. A doting sister to my siblings, and now I was a young Sister Stewart, a saint of the Church of God in Christ, and a child of God. The spiritual bloom had been planted. My preparation came primarily by way of my formal education, despite, or maybe because of the fact, that neither of my parents had much formal education themselves. They were determined that all of their children would be exposed to the best that they could find for their individual talents. My oldest brother, who was a year younger than I, always had difficulty in school, and so he was in special education classes, but he could perform miracles with his hands. And so my parents were always looking for and begging for the opportunity for him to build on his abilities, his skill as to use his hands. My sister, when she was 5 years old, heard someone playing a piece on the piano and sat down and played it. She had never had any music lessons, never been exposed to it. And so my parents, again, always looked for the opportunity to let her develop that ability. My next older brother, right under my oldest brother, was very, very bright. Finished high school at 15, got a full scholarship to Northwestern, but decided he wanted to be the new Jimi Hendrix. And so he did not go to college. But he ended up going on and performing his own business and doing well with his life. And me, from the time I was a kid, don't ask me why, I love math. I love solving puzzles and playing with math, logic games and what have you, and just really got off on it. So between first and 12th grade, I attended 7 different schools. 1 for first through 6th grade, 2 from 7th to 9th grade, and 4 during high school. It was during this period in my life that I began to recognize, value, and appreciate with great humility the fact that others saw a breadth of potential in me that I would never have imagined in myself. In 1964, the Chicago public school system started a permissive transfer plan to allow students from overcrowded schools to transfer to underutilized public schools elsewhere in the city. I lived 7700 South, right off of the expressway. So my parents decided to, quote, give me permission to attend Nicholson High School, which was 6000 North, right off Lakeshore Drive. And of course, I had to take public transportation. However, transferring to Sun High School is what eventually led me to DePaul University, and ultimately to me being here today in all my roundness. And the speech that I gave as I was honored with the Distinguished Alumni Award in College of Law in 2011, pretty much reveals how my blossoming spirit was nurtured as it was preparing to come into full bloom. Now, I have, for the last literally 45 years of my life, been a lawyer. So what I'm going to use a little lawyerism. The first, what I call exhibit, was the talk that I read to you about my experience in church. The second one, exhibit, is that Distinguished Alumni Award speech. And I started with, first of all, let me tell you how tremendously blessed I am. When I was beginning my junior year in high school, my new classmates, in telling me about the new school, warned me that, among other things, I should be prepared for the dreaded senior interview. They told me that during the interview, after indicating what colleges I'd submitted applications to, I would then be asked, well, Ms. Stewart, do you want to be a big fish in a little pond? Or a little fish in a big pond? Same question as he's asked everybody. So during the next year, I received brochures from a number of colleges and universities, and I dutifully read them all. But one school in particular literally courted me like a lover. It not only sent brochures, I got letters, phone calls, and when they learned that I wanted to be a math major, a little round, brown person from the West Side, I even had a personal visit from the head of the mathematics department. So when I was summoned for my senior interview and asked what colleges I was applying to, I, being just as sassy then as I am today, held up my hand to Ms. Keefe and said, Ms. Keefe, I've already made my decision. I do not intend to be anybody's fish in anybody's pond. I want to be a whale in an ocean. I'm going to DePaul. And thus, in the fall of 1966, began my love affair with this university. And now, some 45 years later, as I look back over my time with this wonderful place, I'm moved, humbled, and touched by the impact this relationship has had upon my life. And though the gifts that DePaul has bestowed upon me over the years, surely number in the hundreds, there are three that I know about, with no doubt, could only have come from hearts consumed with love. For these are the gifts that I have relied upon and treasured most of my life in my life's journey to define myself as a person and as a Christian. First of these gifts given to me that have helped me to know and appreciate the purpose. The first of those gifts given to me are those gifts given to me that helped me to know and appreciate the purpose for which I was put here upon this earth. Whether it was working in the kitchen in a free breakfast program in college, or assisting clients in a legal aid clinic in law school, I knew that I was compelled by a need to serve. It is the obligation that my parents instilled in me, and what I have a lot of practice with relative to my siblings, and it is what I love to do. I have come to believe in my heart also. It is what I do best. And it is most assuredly from those who model their lives on the work of St. Vincent de Paul and his love for the poor that I've learned that the service that I render to uplift the heart and spirit is often far more effective than the attention given to external needs. The second of these gifts has made my appreciation for the gift of purpose in my life that much richer and more rewarding. For in learning to forgive, I have learned how to serve more openly, more deeply, more fully, and more completely. And in learning to accept forgiveness, I know what it means to be blessed by and with the services of others. And so I offer to you what in 1968, Father John Cordelieu, the then president of DePaul University, offered to me and a group of ragtag black college students who had just emerged from taking over Schmidt Academic Center. To anyone here today who has ever said or done anything mean or hurtful to me, no matter how dirty, nasty, rotten, low life it was, I here and now forgive you. And in offering my simple gift of forgiveness, I'm reminded that this last gift is the embodiment for me what fuels the engine, which has provided the spark for my relationship with this institution, and that is gratitude. Gratitude for nurturing my mind, body, spirit, and heart in the tradition of people who have been blessed to know how to love. My life is centered and focused, and my heart is at peace because of what Wilburn and Winita Stewart ingrained in me, but in large part for what you DePaul have tended, nurtured, and allowed to blossom within me. And so I end, as I typically do when given an audience to listen to me talk about my love for DePaul. While I pray that I'm an obedient daughter, I hope that I'm a loving and giving sister. I acknowledge that I'm a shamelessly proud mother, for my daughter also is a graduate of the law school. And I trust that I'm a caring and supportive BFF to hundreds. And I do humbly believe that Father Dennis will proclaim, if only for this moment in time, that I am DePaul. Thank you and God bless you. That was the speech that I gave. So, for the formation part of my journey, I thought I might share with you a couple of intertwined moments that epitomize for me the opening up and shameless preening of my fully emerged Christian spirit. After graduating from DePaul Law School and working for government in various capacities, I decided that while I loved public service, I had to get a job that paid decent money. I was less pressed and spilling over when I was approached with an offer to work as a labor attorney for the Bell system. I started with Illinois Bell in 1980 and eventually took a severance package more than 20 years later. But I digress. Within the first year of my employment, I was assigned several cases involving labor disputes between the company and the union in Southern Illinois, and thus would be required to spend quite a bit of time in East St. Louis, Illinois. I've been told in advance by some of my colleagues that while my roundness might not be an issue with, quote, the hairy-legged black men down there, my sex and my brownness clearly would. My very first assignment was to go and try to get the team on board with the notion that we would no longer be a monopoly for much longer, and that in light of deregulation and competition, a change was going to come. And we as employers had to be ready. I knew then that I was dead meat. But I also knew that all I had to do to get past was to get past one inevitable question that I knew would be asked. And that was something akin to, well, why should we do this? Or why should we listen to you? And if I got past that, I would be okay. So I got to East St. Louis the night before, and I was really anxious about trying to figure out what am I going to say to these people that I have never met, that I've heard a lot of very negative things about. And I said, I'm just going to chill. So I turned on the TV, and lo and behold, what was on TV was the story, Jesus of Nazareth. So after watching, I knew exactly what I was going to say. So the next day, I got to the office where the meeting was going to be held, and was confronted with 63 angry-looking white men, one angry-looking black man, and three angry-looking females, all gracious, but clearly angry. So I gave my talk and opened the floor for questions. After fielding them for about half an hour, somebody finally asked, well, why should we do this? What's in it for me? And I was so ready. I simply said, you don't have to do anything that you don't want to do. And it may not have any effect on whether you lose your job or keep it, whether you get promoted or transferred, or any other repercussions relative to the terms and conditions of your employment. However, you may have the opportunity to enhance your skills, or better yet, acquire new ones. You may get the opportunity to go to a totally different location and share your knowledge and skills with others who have less. But please, don't make your decision based on anything other than whatever you choose to do, and whether or not it will make you a better person. One more perfect than you are now by virtue of the choice that you made. Next question. I was floored after the presentation, and I had a line of them waiting to shake my hand and say, what a nice job I've done. So fast forward about 4 years, where I was told by the senior VP of HR that I had been chosen to be part of a team being groomed for bigger things in the film economy. My performance 4 years prior in East St. Louis was one of the incidents that was mentioned as indicating that Ma Bell had been watching me and now wanted to see me rise to new heights. And I just knew I was ready. So, and please, there's a disclaimer. I mean no offense by any of the stuff that I'm going to say. This was Francine when she was full of herself. So I was called into a meeting with about a dozen of the higher-ups. And I'm sitting at this table, of course, I'm the only black person there. I'm one of two women. The other one is the highest-ranking woman at Illinois Bell at the time. And they started talking about ideas for the future. And they kind of went around the table and said, so Francine, what do you think? And I gave, in my humble 37-year-old opinion, what I thought was a very thoughtful and extremely intelligent perspective on the issue. And no one said a word. Then they continued around the table asking others their opinion when they reached Jim LeBlanc. Now you all know who I'm talking about. He's one number one suck up who gets on everybody's nerves. Everybody's last nerve, except the powers that be. So Jim DeMons asked his opinion, and lo and behold, without missing a beat, he literally said the exact thing that I had just said. And suddenly the room came alive, the praises of Jim DeMons. And at that moment, somebody even said something to the effect, what Jim said was spot on. He clearly has an instinct for these issues and blah, 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 blah. And I was pissed. Excuse me. I was so upset, I could not hold my tongue. So in an effort to be a part of the team and to quell my anger, I joined in saying, oh, I agree. And it was just as spot on and intelligent 10 minutes earlier when I said it. At which point, the senior vice president stood up and said, let's take a break. The senior vice president was my assigned mentor. And he had asked for the break, obviously, to give me a lesson in charm and tact. I wish I could say that this incident and the many more like it led to me being more tolerant of gems or the gem-like situations that I consistently have encountered throughout my life. But what did happen was that I learned that I had to become more discerning about myself and my own actions. Specifically, I had to learn to temper my tongue and still my spirit and not agonize over incidents like this that tended to make me feel diminished in some way. I realized that I was the one principally in charge of this aspect of my being, so I was responsible for making sure that he got proper care and nurturing. I was not Jim, I was not blonde, and I clearly was not a sucker. So, in the inimitable words of my 37-year-old daughter, that always will be, I had to let that dream die. And in doing so, I began to free my spirit from so many other things that I realized I could neither control nor master, and to concentrate instead on what I might be able to positively influence. And I believe it was that realization that eventually led me to higher education, and more specifically, to working with young people. It enlightened my path towards transformation. And so, after more than 30 years of warrioring in various capacities, I changed careers somewhat and came into higher education. I had worked for the Bell System for more than 20 years, and I was invited, asked really, to come to a competitor institution down the way, IIT, to the College of Law in Chicago, Kent. And I can honestly say that many of my most transformative moments in my life have come as a result of being an intimate part of the lives of young people, primarily those between the ages of 18 and 30. I've been an administrative dean in two law schools over the last 13 years, and I can say without a doubt that while nothing has played as much havoc with my spirit or my heart as working with young folk, nothing has given me greater joy. The blossoming and growth of my spirit that came about as a result of working in government for 8 years, in corporate America for more than 20 years, literally pales in many respects when compared to the lessons imparted to share with and learn from our children. So let me bring this revelation from my spiritual journey soon to a close by sharing with you one last moment on my path. So when I started with Chicago Kent, I had five different titles, five different jobs, probably about four titles. And one of them was director for, I forgot the title now, but essentially I worked with the students of color in the College of Law. And at the time we had four groups, unlike the College of Law here at DePaul, which has three. We had the Black group, BALSA, the Latino group, Balsam, Wasa, the Asian Pacific group, APALSA, and the South Asian group, SALSA. So it's Balsa, Wasa, APALSA, and SALSA. And they did everything separately. Even though sometimes they would have the same type of event, a networking event, on the same day, literally in the same location, drawing on the same audience, so they all had 20 people at each one of their events. And I said, we have got to find a way to be more collaborative. So one of the things that I am shamelessly bragging about is I made them start a collaborative council, where if nothing more, when they would have to coordinate their events and decide how they were going to do things, when and where, together. So one of the things that they decided after 3 years, they were really into it and loved it. And the thing that they loved most was I suggested that there were so few students of color generally in the College of Law that it might be nice if we did an event, a pre-graduation event, just for the families. And so, and each year we would use one culture as the signature culture for the graduation. And so one year it was the black students, another year it was the Latino students, and so on. And I was always charged with giving the keynote address. So this was the last keynote address I gave at the minority graduation in 2011 before I then became one of the deans in the College of Law here at DePaul. To all the moms and dads, husbands and wives, partners and significant others, aunts, uncles, sisters, brothers, grandparents, cousins, nieces, nephews, and BFFs, thank you for joining us here today to celebrate the gift of your special loved ones. For what we have received, and I take this liberty of speaking for this entire institution, have been indeed gifts. Now, assumed to be new lawyers, if asked to define gift, I'm sure that most of our new proper young lawyers would say something like donative intent, acceptance, and delivery. But I would prefer to use a slightly altered definition given by the American Heritage Dictionary. A gift is something that is bestowed voluntarily, without compensation, and, I would add, is given from the heart. With your permission, I would like to share a little about some of these gifts which were dropped off at our front door some 3 or 4 years ago, and with which we are continuously blessed each year with new packages arriving to seed our community. The primary gifts that they brought to our community were, of course, no surprise. The added richness to the classroom discussions because of their varied experiences in their lives. The creative perspectives gained and unfolded by virtue of just hearing a different viewpoint grounded in experiences that were in many ways very different from our own. And the passion that so often was generated and sometimes even exploded during friendly debates, both inside and outside of the classroom. But let me speak, if I may, about some of what I consider the more endearing gifts which this one humble soul has truly come to treasure. For me, each year, they come in all sizes, shapes, and colors, and they bring with them gifts that sometimes only we, the old, can truly appreciate when we first see them. Or they are the gifts given to us by those who are just beginning those wonderful life journeys. They're the gifts of the face of sheer delight taken when you know you've bested someone in a hard-fought oral debate. And it's that same face bathed in pure, unadulterated pride when you've dressed in your native garb or raised your voice in soulful music and you've shared beauty the beauty and pageantry of your rich culture through dance or song with your bewitched classmates at some school function. It is the gift of the many moments behind closed doors in room 807 that was Dean Francine's office, when you truly have become the teachers and I the student, where you so often allowed me to share the many lives you must live in addition to that of a Kent law student. I see and am truly humbled and moved in learning how you struggle to remain obedient and dutiful to the customs and ways of your elders, while at the same time trying to prepare to fit into a world which undoubtedly will require you to behave in ways which may appear to strain that comfortable coexistence. And it is the gift of breaking bread at the beginning of each year with those you've chosen to lead you, sharing at that table their hopes and their aspirations for the year, and knowing that whatever comes of the efforts, I, more than any of them, will be the richer for it. And so, they say that gifts should never be given with the expectation that one will be received in return. However, I would not be good old advice as Francine Dean Soliunas if I did not leave you with a few gifts of thought that I've been blessed to receive during my life. They are: live long, loving, and forgiving lives. Find something or someone to believe in who you know believes in you, and hold fast to them for the rest of your life. Whether it's a mentor, a parent, a friend, or your spiritual guide, you must have someone or somewhere to turn when you're at your lowest and can't pull yourself up by yourself. Be one who always seeks to know and impart the truth, even in the face of adversity, but always temper your truth with compassion, for often without it, truth becomes merely an excuse for cruel expressions which invariably diminish the spirit of its giver. Find time throughout your life to be alone with yourself and the person that you are, in order to know and understand the person you would like to be. Be at all stages of your life, always, but at all stages of your life, always know if you love the person that you have become. Be explorers. Seek to learn and to know all that your heart, mind, and spirit can contain. Then be gracious and humble when sharing what you have acquired with others. Learn to love unconditionally, for only then can you appreciate the value of such love when you are mercifully granted it. Seek always in all that you do, in all that you say, and in all that you hope to be more perfect beings. To love and respect all without expectation of return. To give of yourself and your goods without expecting repayment, and to offer service to those you meet on the road of life, particularly the poor and the marginalized. And this above all, to thine own self be true, for it shall follow the night and the day, and you then cannot be false to anyone. This is my gift to each of you. Please treasure it, for I have nothing that I can give you which I believe to be of any greater value. And when you are old and have been blessed with undoubtedly full and grateful lives, perhaps you will find it worthy to pass on to those who have gifted you with some abundance. My blessings and those of the entire community now join you on your life's journey. Godspeed. And so, my sisters and brothers, I've tried to give you a glimpse of where my journey from birth to maturation of my spirit has led this one now aging soul. It has been and continues to be a long and often arduous journey, but one I would gladly undertake again and again and again. Because in the end, all that I do, my words, my thoughts, my deeds, my actions, reflect my blessed appreciation for all of the gifts that have been bestowed upon me in these almost 70 years of my life here on earth. And so I leave you with these words from my sister, Maya Angelou. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may tread me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? Cause I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hopes springing high, still I'll rise. Do you want to see me broken, bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries? Does my haughtiness offend you? Do you take it awful hard? Cause I laugh like I've got gold mines digging in my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words, you may cut me with your eyes, you may kill me with your hatefulness, but still like air, I'll rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame I rise. Up from the past that's rooted in pain I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise into a daybreak that's wondrously clear. I rise, bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. Thank you so very much.
On that side so that we can congratulate you and then walk across the stage to return to your seat. What we'll be handing you isn't your full certificate, so at the very end of the event, we'll have you grab that from out of the check-in table.
First nominee, Sarah Ahmad. Siobhan Albiol. Diana Alfaro. Lena Al-Masri, Bushra Amiwala, Claire Anderson, Moshe Bayat, Emily Becker, Monique Billings, Danielle Blackwell, Elizabeth Bowe, Aditi Babshedi, Shannon Bowers, Molly Brown, Katie Brown, Karen Chaven, Leslie Chamberlain, Dong Chang, Christine Harder, Ali Colina,
Nadia Coloma, Shayna Conley, Loyandra Cooper, Graciela Covarrubias, Dara Crawford, Marianne Curta, Verna Donovan, Jennifer Donnellan, Layla Dumaisar, Lubna Agendi, Kathy Ann Elias, Rebecca Feinberg, Tony Fitzpatrick, Elisa Foster, Shelly Frieda, Ellen Golaxon, Christine Gramlich, Phyllis Griffin, Ellen Harrion Fingado, Trisha Hermes, Kelsey Hershenhouse, Kathy Hilligans, Jill Holenbeek, Cherie Holloway, Jean Hopp, Jacqueline Hug, Maya Urban Vitella, Yara Ishmael, Stacy Jackson, Carly Johnson, Kiara Jones, Linda Kahn, Frances Kelleher, Shayla Kendricks, Annette Kessel, Emily Krause, Lauren Chris, Putri Kusomo, Emily LaHood Olson, Kathy Larson, Christina Later, Jennifer Lawhead, Jacqueline Lazou, Katie Leifer, Rosie Leon, Kathleen Liston, Teresa Lurs, Morgan McIntosh Hodges, Lauren McCowardy, Karen McCoy, Virginia McElwain, Molly McInerney, Danielle Meyer, Amy Merrick, Zena Miller, Dominica Moe, Emily Mosher, Alice Moss, Lori Nabloom, Erica Neidlinger, Alexandra Novakovich, Sabrina Olson, Roxanne Owens, Megan Pachola, Mariela Palacios, Amanda Parada Villatoro, Cheryl Price, Heather Quinn, Daniela Reku, Sheena Ramsey, Lucinda Rapp, Hannah Redskin, Felicia Richardson McGee. Barbara Reithoff. Ivana Reiter. Melissa Rivera Piarola. Tanya Rodriguez. Julie Ruvoli. Katie Schubert. Heather Sevner. Jessica Simmons. Kayla Smith. Francine Soliunas. Terry Steinbach. Margaret Story. Gabrielle Strotion. Viviana Suarez. Phyllis Sullivan. Pat Serba. Barbara Tilly. Leslie Triplett Bracey. Donna Voigt. Kate Webster. Tiffany Wiley. Gretchen Wilbur. Barbara Willard. Jennifer. For sure. Romquich.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Liliana Zecker. Louise de Marillac, who was dedicated to giving back to her community and maintaining a high level of compassionate personalism. The women of spirit and action that we have recognized today are masters of accomplishing what they set out to do while helping others and themselves in the process. We are honored to walk among them at our university. Looking forward after today, DWN is offering an exciting slate of programs this year. From faculty forums, to book clubs, to networking and receptions. We sincerely hope that you will join us and invite you to attend as many programs as your schedule will allow. One final item of business before we conclude. Honorees, please make sure before you exit to get your individual certificate at the check-in table. We thank you to everyone who was able to attend today's event and honor the achievements of women at DePaul University. This program has now concluded. Thank you and have a great day. Go Cubs!